Hello, my name is Daniel Jaff. I'm working for Deutsche Telekom and would like to welcome you to my talk about vanilla and distributions and how they differentiate. So let's start. What means vanilla in this context? I would define this for this talk as upstream without any private changes, and it's taken from obviously Git in this case, or from some released packages. But it's important there are no private or proprietary changes within. So sounds great, right, in general. But let's take a deeper look onto that. If you start for your organization with evaluating if you probably choose vanilla or a distribution, you should you know as first what your requirements are really and what's your use case. So you may consider topics like which software do you need? In this case, simply I would say OpenStack, and obviously you also need storage. And in my presentation, I assume here to use Ceph. And you need a basic operation system, including stuff like the kernel and the hypervisor and so on. And you should also know which specific components you probably need in your project from OpenStack. And also what kind of features, for example, from Ceph, like CephFS, or which SDN controller you need, or which hypervisor you want to use, and probably also which API versions of whatever. And for sure, there are also types of operational requirements you have in an organization, like do you want to use CI/CD or topics like automation? And for sure, also topics like all the management of release cycles, updates, upgrades, if you have requirements for special SLAs in your organization, and for sure, also topics like support for your cloud. That means internal and external support. But you also have always topics like cost and efficiency, and probably also legal topics. I come later to that. The second point you should consider is your organization itself. And I have to say, even with full automation of your stack, you absolutely need experienced operators, and for sure also very likely developers. Our experience is that without that, you can't use vanilla. And you maybe also need to change the mindset of the existing people, depending on how old your company is, what the operators and developers did before. And you for sure need also to change a lot of processes. Another topic you need to consider is the community if you use vanilla. And you need to think about how to fix bugs you find and how to add features you have and which are not implemented currently upstream, for example. It's very easy. You should simply participate in the community. That would be, with vanilla, the only way to do it. And that means you report your bugs and your findings, and you report also what you need, your missing features. You open blueprints, and you simply give feedback. And you also start reviewing stuff that other people do. Without that, you will fail with running in vanilla OpenStack. But what then? So typically, open source developers do either what they are interested in or what they are paid for. So if you, that applies to the most of the open source communities. So if you have a bug and nobody of the upstream developers are interested in this topic or don't see the problem, then you probably very likely end up in doing it yourself. So you need to be prepared that you may fix or implement the stuff yourself, otherwise probably nobody will do it if it's not attractive enough or somebody has the same problem as you and is paid for fixing it. So with that in mind, let's take a deeper look
onto the components. First on OpenStack, we have these six core projects, core services, which are really, really mature and also widely adopted in many environments. That's Swift, Keystone, Nova, Neutron, Cinder, Glance, you all know it. But besides that, there are some optional services which are not fully mature, which are simply not considered core services for that, and are not that widely adopted. You may ask why this list is that short. That's simply because these are packages that are really, or projects that are supported by distributions, at least by the distributions I checked. So if you discuss about OpenStack, then the question is always automation. One option would be write your own. Yeah, you can do it, sure, but only if you want to end with an epic fail. Because for sure you can't write that on your own, and with each other update you will stuck in with adapting stuff and changing stuff, and from our experiences that likely ends in a big fail and you're stuck with the version you have. So what does the community, the most of the at least is all experiences, is Ansible, Puppet, and Chef currently, or Crowbar, and that is the most of the stuff that's done. So you maybe ask, what about Fuel and Juju? Yes, it's maybe also an option from my experience if you use Mirantis or Canonical, because 96%, 69% of the code is from these companies. So it's probably the best you stick, at least for Juju with Canonical, and probably also for Mirantis with Fuel. But even then, if you take the automation from the community, you probably even then end with code that doesn't fit your needs. Maybe something missing, or it's not applying to your automation or to your environment. So it can also happen that you take a lot of time, or need a lot of time to even bring up your cloud environment. And I have, for the most people that did automation in our environments on our own or did use vanilla, it took at least a half a year to get it really running for a use case. So, and you may be stuck longer with a release of OpenStack than you think. So especially if you have to fix automation stuff on your own and do a lot of stuff on your own. And very likely that means at the end that's a lot of work for yourself. So what, let's come to Ceph. And in Ceph we have at least two parts that are really mature. That's Rados block devices and this Rados gateway object storage interface. These are yeah, considered as mature. And the other one is CephFS. That's not that mature, but it's on the way to be enterprise ready. So what about automation of Ceph? I can only say check what I said before. So it's applying again, don't do it yourself. And then you can choose from either Ceph deploy, or you could use Ansible, Puppet, and Chef. That's what it's available in the community. Yeah, for sure, it's also Juju available, so, but that is what the community is mostly doing. So what are the alternatives to using vanilla? It's simply using one of the distributions. I choose here for the presentation Red Hat, SUSE, and Mirantis and Ubuntu, meaning Canonical. I left every other like HP solutions out of that. So the question is, what is the preferred solution for your company? So usually I would say, if you are only, for example, in Red Hat shop, it's probably Red Hat. So, but if you are free to choose, you should take a deeper look on the distributions. So let's take a look on Red Hat. For the OpenStack stuff, they have a product called Red Hat OpenStack Platform. It's version 9, and it's coming with Mitaka, and is based on their Enterprise Linux version 7.2. And it's the kernel version on this product is 3.10. So, but don't take it wrong. That is not an old kernel. That is probably there are a lot of patches in a high number of patches. So it's for enterprises. It is not always needed to have the latest greatest EDA bleeding edge kernel. So it's from the number an old kernel, but there is a lot of features from newer kernel versions in. And the available hypervisors are KVM, vCenter ESX, and Docker via OpenShift. If you use this solution, you're stuck with that, or you have to use one of these. For deployment, they use OpenStack Director with OOO and Ansible. You have also the opportunity to use PackStack instead. But it's recommended to use the OSP Director for that. If you take a look on what's really supported within OpenStack from this distribution, from Red Hat, that is true for all of them. The core services are always supported. Six core services are all supported by all distributions, but they differentiate by what they support otherwise. So with Red Hat, it's only Silometer, Heat, Horizon, Orionic, and Sahara is really supported. You get full support. And for the gray ones, you get a technical preview. So it's probably maybe fixed if it's important to get it for the next release ready. But you also have a set of services that are currently not supported with the product. Fuel is only, in general, only supported currently by Mirantis, so that's very clear. But from the rest, the most of them are also really services that have a very low number of maturity, and so one or two in the papers, and that's probably the reason why they don't support it. The life cycle of the product is that they provide packages for every upstream release. So the next one will be Newton, obviously, because they currently support Mitaka, and so you can get an update with every version. And there are additional products recommended, as I said before. OSP Director is one of them. Satellite is also recommended to manage a lot of stuff around the products, and CloudForms. Let's take a look on support. That's very, really different between all the distributions. And Red Hat supports, in the first year, you get full support. That also means you probably get a new feature if you agree on it and get a lot of updates. But in the additional 2 years, they say you still get support for bug fixes, basically. So if there are bugs, you get a fix. But you don't get backports for driver or packages and no installer updates. I said before, one topic is always cost. And here, the pricing is based on socket pairs and machines. And it, as with all the distributions, it highly depends on what you are kind of support you want. Do you want to have only support within the business hours, or do you want to have 24/7, or do you want a special SLA and very short reaction times? So, and it also depends in this case on if you are running RHEL guests in your system or not. So I didn't put any numbers on that because it's really hard to compare, and to be honest, the default prices are usually not that what you pay at the end. So if you are interested in prices, go to Red Hat, SUSE, and whatever, and ask. If you take a look on Ceph, they provide a product that's called Red Hat Ceph Storage. It's version 2, and it's basically a dual release, also based on RHEL, or you have to choose, you can use Ubuntu 16.04 for that. That's deployed via Ansible or via the Red Hat storage console. CephFS is available, but only as a technical preview, and it will be supported in the next release, probably. It's planned, at least. Pricing, as said partly before, it's based on yearly subscription, and it's based on raw capacity with a load limit. You can't have really large nodes, there's a limit in it, and but it's raw capacity. It's, we can discuss if that's what you want. So you need to decide it on your use case. If you have a lot of storage there and it's not full, then it's probably a little bit expensive. And there's also a pre-production subscription available for a low price you can use and can test it, and you still get support. Let's take a look on SUSE. Their OpenStack product, at least the version announced today, it was OpenStack Cloud 7, and it's coming with Newton, and is based on the latest SP2 from SLES 12. And the kernel version here is 4.4. They switched from SP1, that was 3.13 or so, switched with the new release to 4.4. And you have a high number of hypervisors are supported. It's KVM, it's Xen, Hyper-V for Windows, VMware. It's also IBM ZVM, and it's Docker. The automation is done via Kroba and Chef, and the services supported are these. The difference to Red Hat in this case is also that they support basically Magnum and Manila, but Ironic is only a technical preview. And they also support Tempest. The lifecycle management or the product lifecycle from SUSE is different to all the other distributions. They only take every second upstream release and concentrate on making that stable and providing a stable product, and then jump over one, and it's supported to switch between, and they make sure that you can switch to them between them. So the next release will be the PE release in this case. There are also a list of recommended tools, in this case SUSE Studio, for example, to build appliances and SUSE Manager. And for KVM and SAN instances that are not cloud ready, you can also have the SLES HA extension that's basically handling old, not cloud ready applications and make them HA ready, HA ready, sorry. The support is at least 27 months. It's a strange number, right? So it's 2 years and 3 months after the product is released. From the pricing, you have different prices for a control node, for an admin node, and you have the compute nodes that are like with Red Hat socket pair based. So if you have more than two sockets in your machine, you have to pay another subscription. And it's also depending on the type of availability of the support services. With Ceph, we have the SUSE Enterprise Storage solution, and it's also based on Joule and is using Calamari as a front end to monitor it, and it's deployed either through Kroba or in the future it will be deployed via Salt, but that's currently also in technical preview. Features in this case are also like with Red Hat ZFFS as a technical preview, and there's also an iSCSI gateway to connect Windows VMs or VMware VMs to your Ceph cluster. Pricing is a little bit different to the other ones. Here you have a set of basic subscription, and then you pay for additional nodes. There is one difference to all the other distributions. If you have features that you need that are upstream features that go upstream, you don't have to pay for them. If you agree with them, it's part of the subscription. So every other distribution probably charge you with whatever it is per Monday implementing and doing it, but SUSE says that's all included in the subscription because all other users or customers of us will also have something from it, and then so you don't to need to pay. So let's take a look on Mirantis. They are also based on Mitaker, but they are the only distribution that don't maintain an own basic OS or a base OS. So they you can choose between, for the controller nodes, it's only Ubuntu, either 14.04 or 16.04, and for compute nodes, you can choose between Ubuntu, RHEL, Oracle, and SUSE. Not sure if that's very common to run different base OSs in your cloud, but you can choose it. There are cases where our customers need that. The kernel base basically depends on the base OS, and the supported hypervisors are KVM, Xen, and VMware. Deployment via Fuel, I said that before, and the list of supported packages are these. They basically also support Murano, it's one of their projects basically, and they have no packages which are considered technical preview and not fully supported. Lifecycle as with this Red Hat, every upstream release within 1 or 6, between 1 and 6 months after the release. And the next one will be with Newton in the next year. It's recommended to use Mianta Stacklight for monitoring and so on, and probably the partner catalog they provide for stuff like billing and so on. They supported 3 years, their product. And the pricing depends on your base OS, basically. So for Ubuntu, it's per machine, and for RHEL, it's per socket pair. And I guess it's the same for SUSE, but there was no information on that. So with Ceph, it's a little bit different to the other ones. It's part of the OpenStack distribution, not of the base OS. And currently, it's Hammer, Ceph Hammer with Ubuntu. And it will also be in the next release. So it's a little bit older. It's one stable release behind what the other ones are using. And deployment also via a Fuel plugin. And due to the fact that it's Hammer, it's only RBD and router scale that's supported, so nodes with Ceph support. Pricing is for Ceph based on gross capacity. So let's come to Ubuntu. The OpenStack product is also Newton-based, and it's Ubuntu 16.04. And the kernel is, as now with SUSE, 4.4-based, and the hypervisors that are supported are KVM, Hyper-V, and LXD. So let's get one thing out of the way. The canonical OpenStack solution is probably not what you expect to be the same as the Ubuntu OpenStack. That's very confusing, or is often confused by people that saying Ubuntu is widely used and the product is widely used, but in fact, between the most upstream developers, it's the community version that is used. So the enterprise version is basically using also Juju and Mars, while the most community developers are using probably DevStack, Puppet, Ansible, or Chef to do their product. So it's, if there are numbers in some poll to check how many users are using Ubuntu, that's probably not the same as using the enterprise product. The supported services, from the additional services, currently only Silometer and Horizon are really supported. Probably surprising for some people. The other ones, most of the other ones are supported as, unsupported as technical preview, so it's not full supported for production. Lifecycle is every upstream release, and the recommended product is Lenscale for system management and security compliance and auditing. And the support, to be honest, I find it really complicated. Generally, the LTS version is 5 years supported, but what you can have within the LTS release, you can have updates or can have new OpenStack releases. But these are only then 1.5 years supported. And even if you are on an LTS version, at the end of the lifetime of the LTS version, you get an update to the OpenStack version that's part of the next LTS, and that's then 3 years supported. So I don't know. It's a very complicated matrix to find out what really is currently supported with your product and how long is it supported. The pricing is per node and year, or per VM and hours. They have a lot of different models, or per OpenStack regions, if they are small or large, medium, and so on. And as with the others, it highly depends on what kind of support you want. With Ceph, they provide a product called Ubuntu Advanced Storage. With Joule and a tool called Ubuntu Performance Dashboard to check what's going on your cluster and see where you have performance problems probably. The pricing is based on used capacity. Sounds nice. In general, from my point of view, you have three potential issues. Landscape and the Ubuntu Performance Dashboard have a non-open source license. It's a proprietary license. So whatever happens when Canonical goes bankrupt or something like that, or probably it's even a compliance problem for you. So you should know that. And the other one is the kernel. And I would say it's at least a controversial integration of ZFS. You probably followed the discussion in the community. Build your own opinion on that. It is at least controversial. So there are probably problems for you. So let's take a look on how would you assess which distribution can provide support for your project, for your cloud environment. So marketing? Just kidding. Rhetoric question. So if you are lucky, you made your own experiences. So if you are already probably a Ubuntu shop or a Miantos shop or a SUSE or Red Hat, then you probably stick to that and you know what you get. Or you know somebody that can say that's good or that won't work or whatever. So if you have a lot of time, or at least have some time and have the resources, I would really recommend evaluation of the products and do a POC. All of them provide their enterprise product for at least 60 days or so to download and test it and get all updates. So use it, install it, and make your own experiences with that before you stick with one. Because I have to say, everybody says it's probably easy to switch from one to another or from vanilla to a distribution, but that's not true. So it's not very easy to fix. If you have something in production, you don't change that easily. So another indicator would be to probably take a look on what is the contribution of these distributions to the core components of your project. So probably on OpenStack, on Ceph, KVM, kernel, whatever. I put some numbers together. Let's take a look on OpenStack. These are the commits between the Grizzly and the current O-release or upcoming O-release for the core projects. As you can see, currently Red Hat did the most and Miantis is coming up. The other ones depends on. Looks the same for the selected OpenStack optional projects. In this case, yeah, build your own opinion. I also took a look on how many reviews are done. So that's, for me, it's also important that the if you don't, you should also participate in bringing the project forward. And one of that would be to review bugs or to do reviews. And that's the numbers from the core and the before optional projects. To be honest, it still looks the same. The only difference is the bug fix ratio. I checked how many bugs are opened by the distribution and how many are fixed. It doesn't mean that they fixed what they opened, but you get an idea on the behavior of the distribution. If they only open bugs and wait for it, that somebody in the community is fixing it, or if they are going and fixing. I also took a look on documentation and translations. That's one of the numbers. And surprisingly here, SUSE is really concentrating on that and bringing forward the project documentation. If you remember some years ago, the documentation really sucked. And at least they are doing this work, reviewing, checking what is missing and what's wrong and fixing it. So let's take a look on Ceph. It's the same colors, but it looks a bit strange. So, as you can see, You only see currently Mirantis, Suzy, and Red Hat. Obviously, I mean, it's a Red Hat project. The numbers for Red Hat are from Inktank and Red Hat together. So there are some commits from Canonical. It's 28 over all the time, over the complete project. Let's take a look on the kernel. That's for all the kernel releases, for the standard kernel releases in the standard Linux 3. That's generated from the tool that's used by the kernel community for making the release informations together and who contributed how much. So here you obviously see that Suzy and Red Hat are the most active, but also even Mirantis contributed. So I checked out all the stable trees and checked if there is something different, because I expected if you have an LTS kernel for what distribution ever, you stick for some time with it and you probably hit bugs and you need to fix it. So I checked it, but to be honest, it makes no difference. It's still the same behavior. And if you take a look on KVM and libvirt, in this case it's libvirt and kuemo Git repositories, because KVM is already in part of the kernel, so that's covered by that, and it looks the same. So I'm at the end of my presentation. You can download the presentation from GitHub and simply scan the QR code, and yeah, I'm open to questions. Could you take a microphone or so to get it on the video stream? Is there a microphone for the audience? Yeah, then say it and I repeat it.
Just comment. If I'm serious. The contribution is serious from Canonical Ubuntu when it comes to packaging, preparing the Debian package, while they haven't included the support of so many non-core OpenStack services in their distribution.
The question is, what is supported, right? I mean, if you pay support, the real question for you as a distribution is what is really supported, and that's in here, so yes.
Yeah, okay. Another question. So have you compared the installation? Do you have a first-hand experience, time, complexity, anything?
So I would recommend to check the presentation from Florian Haas from Tokyo for that. I didn't do it again. That's It was basically evaluation, and it was not how long one needs and what's good. So he did a very big, good presentation on that, and I would recommend to check that, this one. Yeah. Politically correct, we use Ubuntu. And? Canonical, yeah. We are using Canonical. At least for the project I'm working in, but there are other parts in the company that are using Huawei, as you heard before, with underneath SUSE. And there are also parts in the company using Red Hat, so it's the project I'm working on that's using Canonical. It's not the complete company, it's a big company.
It's fine, okay. I just said that in our company we use Mirantis Fuel without their support. We use it by ourselves. And we pretty much like it. But are there any other distributions that can be used for free?
With Fuel?
Not necessarily with Fuel.
So, sorry, I didn't get the question. So
I mean, are there any other distributions that can be used also for free?
There is obviously Ubuntu for free. I mean, Ubuntu, not the commercial thing, the community thing. You can use it, or you could use Debian, whatever. Yeah, make you happy, it's no problem. I don't know if Fedora and OpenSUSE are really concentrated on OpenStack, but there are packages. So for sure there is OpenSUSE with packages, and I guess there are is also Fedora with packages for OpenStack. That's not the question. They are available, for sure. Sorry? Or RDO, yeah.
RDO by Reddit, right?
Yeah. So anyway, if you do vanilla, you probably even have to choose, anyway, your basic distribution. So, yes. And all of them provide a way to run them with OpenStack. Yes? No, I left them out. There are two, for me, they are too specialized on very special topics. So that I mean before was you need to know your use case. There are use cases for using probably the HP products or some other things. So, but I concentrated for this presentation on the four major distributions. No. But to be honest, I didn't check it because we did the evaluation on our own. So with our own requirements, and it was a very long list. Any other questions? No? Then thank you.